In November 1971, I got drafted. I thought that my world was over. I thought it was the end of everything. I went into the Army, I went to boot camp, and I went into advanced individual training down in Fort Polk, Louisiana. When I came out for 5 days of leave in April of 1972, April 17th, I came home on leave. I turned the radio on in the car, and I heard a song. Stop, look, listen. I said, who are these guys? I've never heard this song before. It shocked me. I was surprised, but I fell in love with it. Well, I found out who these guys were, and these guys are this man sitting next to me, Russell Thompkins Jr. We're at Russell's home, north of Philadelphia. He invited us in to tell us a little bit about the history, his musical history, his contribution to American history, and the Stylistics. Russell, thanks for inviting me out here, because I've got to see some things that I've never seen before. The Uptown Theater.
Yes, yes.
And some of the great scenery here in Philadelphia, where you grew up. A little bit about your personal history before you became a Stylistic. Were you always musically inclined?
Yes, I think I was born with it. My father sang. So my mother said when I was about 5 or 6 years old, she said she knew it. She knew I had the same thing.
How did she know that? Were you singing?
From my father.
What were you singing? Church, around the house, in school?
No, around the house. It was a lot of music around the house. So my father used to sit me and my brother down and give us little music lessons about how we should be, and this is how this person was. He put a record on, he'd sing along with it and show us certain techniques and things like that. And I think I picked up on that. My brother, my father was an artist also.
What kind of an artist?
He painted. Yeah, he was drawings and paintings. And my brother got that.
Brother, was your brother older or younger?
14 months younger.
14 months younger.
And he got the art aspect, but my brother could sing also. So he actually got two things, I got one. Just the singing part of it.
But what you got, you did well with, from what I remember. Now, did your father perform? Was he a performer?
Yes, he did. He performed here. I never got a chance to see him perform. And my grandmother and a lot of people who saw my father when he was doing nightclubs and different shows here in Philadelphia, well, on stage, I was exactly like him.
Now, inside your house, you've got about a dozen keyboards, every room in the house. Among your gold records and all of the great photographs, you've got keyboards everywhere. Did your father play keyboards?
No, he didn't. He messed around with piano a little bit. I didn't play keyboards at all. I messed around a little bit over the years from working with different producers and different arrangers. I learned to come home and sit down at the piano and figure out what key I sang in and what would be the appropriate key for me to sing, you know, for the songs that I was recording. And I learned to play some chords, and I learned to do that over the, I guess, the 30-something years, 40 years I was first out there. And when I left working with the original Stylistic group, I wanted to go back to school, and I went to music school.
Where did the name come from? What is a Stylistic?
A guy by the name of Robert Douglas thought about that. He also was one of the writers of our first song, You're a Big Girl Now. He was a guitar player. We came from two different groups, the Monarchs and the Percussions.
And which group were you with?
I was with the Monarchs. Arian Love, James Smith, and myself was with the Monarchs, and James Dunn and Herb Morrell was with the Percussions. But we used to sing against each other in talent shows.
Kind of like a battle of the bands type thing.
In high school.
What high school did you go to?
I went to Walter Biddle Saul Philadelphia High School of Agriculture and Horticulture. These talent shows, and the other guys went to Benjamin Franklin High School. And I used to come down to Benjamin Franklin High School to hang out with them when I got out of school. That's where we would sing and do certain things, you know, hang out together. But to get back to how the name happened, when we graduated from school in 68, some members of both groups went into the military, and some went on to further education. And an English teacher in Benjamin Franklin High School was our manager at the time. She had the idea of taking members from both groups and putting them together. And when people...
Taking the best or taking what was left?
What was left.
What was left.
Yeah, what was left. In fact, when that was going on, when the Monarchs broke up, I left. And I went to live with my father for a while. And I met a whole new group of people up in a different section of Philadelphia.
Where were you growing up in Philadelphia?
I grew up in North Philadelphia, but my father lived in the Tioga area. That's the area where my wife and my brother-in-law grew up at. And when I moved up in that area, I sang with another different group. I got with a group called the Dynamic Showmen, and I sang with them for that summer. Monarchs and the Percussions got together. They came, the English teacher came to talk to me and asked me would I come back and sing in the group. And when I came back to sing with them, the guitar, one part of the group wanted to use percussions.
But back then, you didn't know if it would fit?
No, you just used the name. It didn't matter what you called us.
Well, you just wanted to perform. You just wanted to sing and get on stage and do what you love doing.
Yeah, it was a funny thing with myself. I sang all the time. When I was in school, like I said, my father would show me some musical things. But music kept coming into my life. I wasn't trying to go and do music. It would just happen. When I was in elementary school, I guess I sang all the time. A teacher in elementary school said, I want to put you in the Glee Club because you like to sing all the time. So I got in the Glee Club.
But weren't you also involved in sports?
Yes, I played. I ran track in elementary school, and that's when I first fell in love with playing basketball. As much as I loved basketball and as well as I could play, I never played on a basketball team in school. I played in the recreation leagues and different CYO leagues here in Philadelphia when I was growing up. But I never played in high school or in school because when I went to junior high school, I was a soccer player and I got hurt. And when I got hurt playing soccer, they wouldn't let me play on the basketball team. So that was another thing, how music just kept coming in there. When I didn't do that, I sang in the Glee Club in junior high school. I was the only boy in the girls' chorus in junior high school and school.
How do you explain that? Is that because of your voice, because of what you sang, your range?
That and there was a music teacher by the name of Miriam Minyard. She held a talent show in junior high school that me and a couple of guys that I played basketball with went on stage and sang a R&B song. I forget which one, what the song it was, for fun. And at the end of the talent show, she said, I want to see you on the fifth floor in the music room at lunchtime. And I didn't know what for. And when I went upstairs and she sat down and she played scales and different things and told me to sing whatever she played. And I did that. And for the rest of the time I was in junior high school, we were inseparable. She was teaching me harmony, teaching me how to sing. And she also ran the girls' chorus. So I was the only boy, since I was there with her, the only boy that sang solos with the whole girls' chorus singing background for me, too. But a funny thing, there was a group of girls in the girls' chorus that became a singing group here in Philadelphia. They were the Ritchie family, and they had recorded. When we did an R&B talent show, Fox Junior High School was a very musical school. I guess you can get from the way I've been talking. A lot of people sang. They gave a lot of shows. And these girls end up becoming one of the biggest groups here in Philadelphia. They traveled with James Brown. They did a lot. They were first called Honey and the Bees. Then they became the Ritchie family. And they sang background for me at a talent show in junior high school. One of the singers in that group, her name was Gwendolyn. She ended up marrying Fred Wesley from James Brown's band. So that's another connection that we had with James Brown.
Did you know James Brown?
Yes, I did.
How did you know him? As a person or as a performer on stage?
I knew him both ways. After we finished our first record, You're a Big Girl Now, we signed with a management company called Universal Attractions in New York.
Now, You're a Big Girl Now. That was a regional hit, am I right? That wasn't a national hit.
It became after a while.
After you hit it big with Stop, Look, and Listen?
Yes.
Yes, that's how I heard it.
Yes.
I didn't hear it when it first came out.
No, it was a hit record here in Philadelphia, in New Jersey, and it went down as far as Baltimore and Washington at first. And there's a funny story about that, too. In that year when we became the Stylistics, like I said, it was my last year in high school, I went back to school and Arian Love went back to school. We both went to a school here in Philly called Dobbins. He took a course in computers. I took a course in making and repairing musical instruments. So while we were in school, we were, you know, I was 17, getting ready to turn 18. We had jobs also. So we went to school part-time and had jobs. A guy who picked up management from the music teacher after about a year said he had a gig for us to do in Newport, Rhode Island. We had never been that far before.
Had you ever been on stage with this group before?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we had worked locally. There were so many nightclubs in Philadelphia at that time that every weekend we worked either at a nightclub or did a cabaret. So he had this gig in Newport, Rhode Island. And when we went to Newport, Rhode Island, we all had to quit our jobs, quit going to school, or whatever we did. We had to make a decision to do a two-week engagement. But while we were there, our families and girlfriends and wives all came up to see us. And it was right after we had recorded "You're a Big Girl Now." They came up and told us, "You know, y'all better get up for this."
They're playing it on the radio.
Yeah, they played it on the radio all day and every day. And that's how we found out. When we came home, all of a sudden, everybody in Philadelphia knew us. You know, they knew about the group and things. That's when things, very, you know, in the beginning, when it started to happen.
So when you were up in Newport, Rhode Island, this was the summer of 68?
Yeah.
What are you singing?
Temptation songs.
Okay. My Girl.
OJ's. Yeah, we did. In fact, we knew the whole Mellow Mood album. Yeah, that's still one of my favorite albums. We were Temptations fanatics. When Temptations and Four Tops, because that was the music that became our music.
Yeah.
When we grew up listening to our parents' music, which, you know, I loved. I loved everything that my parents listened to. They listened to the artists that I listen to now. Gloria Lynn, Arthur Prozac, Billy Eckstein, Sarah Vaughan, Ella Fitzgerald, Joe Williams, all of them type of people, because my father knew them and could sing that type of music. And but Motown came around about, what, 59, 60?
Shop Around, yeah.
Yeah, I was 10 years old, 11 years old then.
Yeah.
And that music hit me right away. Marvin Gaye and all of my... And
Barrett Strong, Money.
Yeah, I could sit down and listen to that music and I could sing it. And I grew up with a guy that was in the Monarchs by the name of Alvin Ranton. And he wore glasses and he was David Ruffin and I was Eddie Kendricks.
Oh, yeah, I could see that. Okay.
And we would go to the corner store, had a jukebox in it, and every summer when the new Motown records would come out, me and him would drop dimes in there and learn every Motown
song. And sing those parts.
And sing them parts. And that's how we grew into, you know, becoming R&B singers. And that summer of 1968, before we went on the road, the English teacher knew a guy who was the bodyguards for the Temptations, and they worked at a club over in Camden, Cherry Hill, New Jersey, called the Latin Casino. So she got us an audience with the Temptations. David Ruffin was still there, because David was there that evening. And we went backstage, we got a chance to meet the Temptations, and I sang for them. And that was 68, so about 4 years later, I was singing at the Apollo Theater. Eddie Kendricks was there.
72.
Yep, I got a chance to talk to him, and he said, "You know, I remember you." And that started another friendship, you know, because I told him, I said, "I listened to everything you've ever made, everything that they've ever put out, and I can sing your songs." And we became friends.
So in 72, Damon Harris was with them too.
That's...
Papa was a Rolling Stone.
Yeah, Eddie had left the group when I saw him at the Apollo. And the reason why he was at the Apollo, not to do the show, he was managing a group at that time called the Posse. And they were on the show with us also at the Apollo. It was the Posse, Stylistics, Al Green, Laura Lee, and Wilson Pickett.
And Eddie didn't say, he didn't do Keep on Trucking or any of that stuff?
No, he just came there to see his group. Well, we ended up working together a few times after that meeting. Me and you were talking about the theaters in the round. One of the reasons why I remember the theater in the round in Nanuet is because that's a gig that me and Eddie did together. It's funny. In 1973, I was
still in the Army in 73, and you're talking 73. I can hear, because in the barracks, everybody played. We didn't have walls. We just had cubicles. So there might be 200 guys in there. And you could hear all this with Papa Was a Rolling Stone, Stone in Love with You.
Yeah.
You know, we hear all this stuff. It all depends where you wanted to stand, what you're going to listen to, what song you're listening to. But go ahead. I'm sorry. 1973.
In 73, I was working with Eddie. And that was around the time when I was not getting along with the fellas in the original Stylistics. And I wanted to leave the group. And, I was young and I couldn't really see everything that was going on, but I knew that I didn't want to be there. That was after we had done the first three albums, the original three albums with Tommy Bell.
What were the three albums?
It was the Stylistics debut album, Round Two, and Rock and Roll Baby. And Tommy was getting ready to leave working with us. Tommy Bell is the arranger and producer of the first three albums of Stylistics ever done.
How did you get to be working with Tommy Bell?
Well, when Your Big Girl Now came out and it started to grow, like I said, in the tri-state area, they wanted to push it out a little further. So the people, it came out on a local label here in Philadelphia by the name of Sebring.
Yeah.
The Intruders were the act. You know, I knew them. We came from the same neighborhood, and I knew them because they were older than me. And in fact, when we first went on the road, we would be late for shows all the time. I mean, the Stylistics, man. We were late so much they were calling us the Late Listings. So we would make it to a show.
I would think that you young kids would say, hey, we don't want to do anything wrong to mess up our gig. We've got to get there on time.
It was the transportation we had.
Oh, okay.
It was really
shabby. Guys
were
riding on donkeys or broken down, whatever.
Yeah, it was really shabby. And we would end up being late for shows. And I remember one time we were working a show in Washington, D.C., Teddy Powell shows at the Warner Theater. And we were late. Wilson Pickett jumped on us. Boy, he was hollering and screaming about y'all stylists, y'all late, you need to find them, you need to take your money from them. And we were young kids, and they hollering and screaming at us, and they were, you know, older people. And one of the guys in Intruders, I remember, came over and to our defense. And I see him now. He used to live in this area. We signed with the company after we had left, after Your Big Girl Now, with Universal Attractions. Universal Attractions owner and was named Jack Bart. And Jack's father, Ben Bart, was James Brown's manager. He's also in the movie. You'll see him. He's Dan Aykroyd played him. But Jack Bart became the Stylistics' third manager. And we signed with Universal Attractions. The president of Universal became the Stylistics' manager. And he took us to Afro Embassy Records. And that's when we started doing the AFCO sent me to Tommy Bell. That's the original question. Yes,
I was just going to say
how
that.
How I met Tommy Bell.
Because this is after You're a Big Girl Now, Ebony Eyes.
Yes.
But before the big hits start rolling.
Right. Jack Bart sent us to AFCO Records. AFCO Records told me to go down to the Schubert Building Monday morning and meet this guy named Tom Bell.
You didn't know who he was.
I didn't know anything about
Tom
Bell.
Care.
But I knew all his music.
Did you?
Yeah, because he had been the producer, arranger, and writer for the Delphonics. And I was insane about William Hart's voice. I loved Eddie Kendricks. The next voice that I loved was William Hart. There was three tenors at that time that I listened to, and I would try to emulate and sing their songs. It was Eddie Kendricks, William Hart, and Eddie Holman.
Hey there, lonely girl.
Hey there, lonely. He lives in the neighborhood too. I see him when I'm jogging around the street here. Eddie comes behind me and honks his horn and scares me to death. And we just finished doing a show together in Williamsport. But Eddie is still doing well. And he's a wonderful person too. I was in junior high school, and there was a big DJ here in Philadelphia by the name of Georgie Woods, and he had a show called 17 Canteen. And I saw two people that really influenced me when I was a teenager, watching them on a TV program. It was Barbara Mason, and it was Eddie Holman. And I remember sitting in front of the TV looking at Eddie, saying to myself, you know, I can do that. I can sing that song. You know, and that helped me along too. And Eddie talk about that a lot. He's one of my favorites. Tommy Bell was doing William Hart of the Delphonics, so I knew all of their music also. So when I had that meeting that Monday morning working with Tommy Bell, we sat down at the piano. He started playing songs for me, and I started singing along. And a lady came in the room, and that was Linda Creed. Linda Creed was the lyricist and songwriter with him.
You didn't know her though?
I had worked with Linda.
Oh, you had?
Years earlier. So that had to be in 1970 when I met Tommy. In 1968, I did a cabaret here in Philadelphia, and Linda was one of the singers on the show. That all led to management sending us on the road with James Brown. And that was in 1970. And I think that was a week after me and my wife got married. That was our honeymoon.
I was just going to say, your honeymoon was James Brown.
35 one-nighters.
Wow.
With James.
All in succession or over a period of 2 or 3 months?
Over a period of time.
Okay.
You know, but we travel from Chicago to Dothan, Alabama. I mean, James was the workingest and most fantastic entertainer I've ever seen in my life.
On stage, but he's also the workingest off stage?
I never saw that side of him. I would be in his audience. Whenever I would go to New York, we'd stop in the office and go up and see him and sit down and talk to him. I would, after a show, he would call me in his office, and I'd sit down and I would talk to him. He would give me advice, and James was a fascinating man. I mean, James was the first artist I ever was around that he was the real deal. I mean, when they talk about somebody being a superstar, he lived that way. He was Mr. Please, Please. And he let you know. He was a really fascinating guy. And we used to break all his rules. We were young then. We were crazy. We went on the road with James Brown, and the other act that was on the road with us, we were the same age, was Dramatic. James had all these rules. I mean, he had rules about doing this and rules about doing that, and we broke them all. Them damn Stylistics and Dramatics, why bring them out here with us? I ended up working with James all the way until, let me see, that had to be 1970. I worked with him all the way up until 99. He took us all over the world. If it wasn't for James, I don't think there would be a Stylistic.
Really?
Because during that time, nobody could see who the act was because there were no videos. All you did was you heard the voices, you heard the records. But James gave us that exposure, took us on the road. And when you went to a James Brown concert, I worked at the Superdome with James Brown, and he was like packing the places out. I mean, people got a chance to actually see you, and that's what made, because at one time there was a phony Stylistic group out there saying that they were us.
At the same time you guys were big and performing?
All around that time, yeah.
Wow.
Was trying to break into it, and we had to, we almost got into a real heavy confrontation with them once in Washington, D.C.
I can imagine if you confront them.
Yeah, almost like a West Side Story type
yeah.
of thing. Yeah. I said we were a little crazy when we were young.
I don't want to know about that. I don't want to hear that.
And that exposure eliminated all that trying to impersonate, you know, type of thing. But James played a big, big part in my career. I used to watch him. After I sang background for him, too. I used to be in the back singing background while he was on stage. But before that happened, I used to go out front and sit there and watch him. And to this date, I have never seen anything like that. I mean, Michael Jackson was something else. But James Brown was... I mean, James was... the real deal. I mean, everybody has gained something from James' music and James' dancing and James' artistry. Everyone who's ever done anything has gained from that, from the hip-hop guys all the way back to us. I learned to move around on the stage. I would watch him do certain things, you know, his confidence and the way he used the microphone. And I started learning little tricks with James, and I've been very competitive my whole career. And when I went on stage, I didn't like the fact that somebody, I took a back seat to somebody, you know, when I was on stage singing, you know. I think the basketball did that. I always tried to win. So I would watch James. And I don't even want people sitting there watching me saying, all right, hurry up, we're waiting for James to get off stage.
You felt that when you were on stage at times?
Yeah, at times. I said, oh, wait a minute. Let me think of some things here to do. Putting the microphone down, walking across the stage and singing in large buildings with no mic. Carnegie Hall, I did that. And the acoustics in there were so good that you didn't need a microphone. And you could hear my voice all over the place. And I started doing that for years. I did it for a long time until I couldn't do it anymore.
Yeah?
Yeah. The older I got, that strength, you know, started to wane a little bit. I had a lot of energy. I had a strong falsetto when I was much younger. And I found that could work. And that got me over a lot. I mean, at the Apollo Theater, Lincoln Center, especially buildings, like in Japan, when we played the Sun Plaza in different areas, different buildings that had that great acoustic, you know, where you could... Actually, if the crowd was really, really quiet, and the Japanese, no crowd gets quieter than a Japanese
really?
Crowd. I mean, when you're singing on stage, no one makes a sound. They don't clap, they don't do anything until the song is finished, and they listen to it from first note to the very last note, then make sure they appreciate it. So that was a quiet atmosphere, and that type of atmosphere is perfect for putting the microphone down and walking to the edge of the stage and singing and hitting certain ad-libs and stuff. And that worked for me for a long time until I couldn't do it anymore. You know, as you get older, my natural voice I've never had a problem with. I could sing my natural tenor. Even now, I could sing my natural tenor in that same way. But I can't do the falsetto like that anymore.
The cycle of life moves along.
Exactly.
We have to adapt.
Exactly.
But you're still...
I have no problem, you know, as long as I can make music and continue to sing, you know, as God is willing, you know, I'm 64 years old and I'm still trying.
You go see Tommy Bell, you meet Linda Creed, what are you thinking?
I was saying to myself, this is something different. I said, this is something, because I had never did anything that was mine. And Tommy Bell said, first thing I'm going to do is bring that voice down, because I used to sing very, very high at that time. And he said, I'm going to bring that voice down and let you sing in this register and sit down at the piano and let me do this. And I liked it very much. I remember thinking to myself, this is very, 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 very good. But I still wasn't thinking about having a hit record or doing anything like that. That wasn't on my mind. I was used to learning. When I was singing in the choir, and I sang in the city's choir, Philadelphia All-City Choir, we would go to rehearsals, and that was the whole process of rehearsing, singing, learning new songs, learning that. So that became my focus of doing everything, just learning songs. I wasn't always the best singer, but I was always the guy who knew the words. You know, when I would hear a song, I could listen to it one time or two times, and I knew the song almost all the way. Tommy used to take me down there and work with me, and he would tell you that himself if you interview. That same day that me and him would sit down and play a song, I could record it right after that. We could go right in the studio and cut it right away. I wouldn't have to have, you know, a week or 2 weeks. You know, right now at my age, when somebody bring me a song, it takes me a little time. I have to take it and live with it and let it become me and see where my voice can go and what I'm capable of doing. Back then, you just give me a song and I just sang it. And it was like studio quality, just to sing it. After working with Tommy, I could sing and work with any producer in the world. I mean, and another thing, when I would sit down at the piano and sing Stop Looking, Listen to them songs, Tommy sang them to me. Because he has a wonderful voice. So I'm sitting there listening to him singing. All I had to do was almost emulate.
I was just going to ask you that. So you're telling me that all you had to do was put your voice in the place of what you just heard.
Yes.
And, so
and
when
give
you heard,
it my spirit and give it my
your perspective.
Twist.
Yeah. Yes. So when you heard him sing Stop Looking, Listen, did you record it that day? Did you record it the next day? What happened?
Probably not too long after that. And Stop Looking, Listen was a song that it was my favorite Tommy Bell song.
Well, it was your first.
My first.
Okay? And it takes time for people to grow.
Yeah.
Okay? And to change and adapt. So I can't say that it was the most perfect song either.
The B-side, If I Love You, that's the one that I like.
You like it better?
Yep. That's the one that I like. And it didn't do anything.
I was just going to say, it wasn't a hit.
No.
You sang lead on that song. Who backed you up on that song?
Tommy Bell, Kenny Gamble, Carl Helm, Bunny Siegler, and a guy by the name of Phil Hurt. Phil Hurt, I think you would know him better by being the writer of the Spinners' I'll Be Around. I think he did that. He wrote that.
Now, you didn't mention to me any of the names of the Stylistics.
None of them sang.
Explain that to me.
Tommy Bell didn't like them. He didn't like their voices, and he didn't want to use them. He didn't like the other members of the group at that time, their voices, and, you know, he didn't want to use them. He just wanted to use me.
Now, how long did this continue?
Well, I talked to Tommy. At that time, me and Arian Love, were best friends. And I talked to Tommy about getting Arian to let him come in and record, you know, with us. He let Arian come in, and Arian sang a harmony part on You Are Everything with me. And then he didn't do anything else on them albums until You Make Me Feel Brand New. And he's the second voice on You Make Me Feel Brand New. But the other guys never sang on anything that we did with Tommy Bell.
The first three albums?
Yes. And I fought for them. I mean, I really did. In fact, I fought very hard for them when we went to H&L Records and worked with Hugo Luigi on the Let's Put It All Together album. I mean, to the point where they had offered me to leave the group. And I think it was earlier when me and you were talking, and I was talking about Eddie Kendricks. When I wanted to leave in 73, Eddie Kendricks said, "Do you know how many people you're feeding?" He said, "All them guys out there that's singing with you and the guys in the band and all of them," he said, "their families live off of what you're doing." And he talked to me a long time about that, and that's what made me stay.
Now here's Eddie Kendricks who left the Temptations.
Yes, Eddie Kendricks.
But telling you that he learned from his lesson.
Yes, probably. Yeah. And in hindsight, I wish I had left.
Well, it would have been better for you is what you're saying.
Maybe. You never know. You know, when me and my wife talk about it, they are part of the lessons that made me what I am now. You know, going through, I worked there from 1973 to 1999, and every year it got worse. And every year it became a job.
Can you tell me, do you want to tell me what worse means? I mean, going to work and you're not happy, it's reflected in what you produce.
It is. It got very bad.
What was so bad? What was so unhappy?
The personal relationship. The personal relationships got bad first. Then it came down to dollars and cents and work. I can't continue to go in the studio and do all the work, do all the singing. We're a singing group. I can't continue to do that because we're making the same amount of money. we're doing the same, you know, doing the same thing. You have to step up.
You mean everybody shared equally in the stylistics?
Equally.
You're doing all the heavy lifting.
Exactly. But the thing was, when Tommy wouldn't work with them, and I can still see this memory, I mean, I can see it in my mind, of sitting down with the five of us and me telling them, nothing's going to change. No matter what these records do or whatever go on, we're going to split this money down evenly. You know, because we had done things for each other. We were brothers at that time. As the years went on, things changed. And it, you know, it got to the point where I couldn't be around them. I didn't want to sing or rehearse with them. All I did was go to the shows and do my show, and I would leave. And people could tell that I was unhappy. People would tell me, why you never smile on stage? Why you never do this? Why you never talk? It's because I was just, the only time I was happy is when I had the microphone in my hand and I was singing. Because I had the audience then. I could block out everything else, all them other things, and just sing. And that's the time that I was happy. I remember in the 90s, it became really, really tough because there were other problems going on at that time. I started having problems with the Internal Revenue. My everyday life wasn't going well. And the pressures of that put something on me that I've never felt before. I would go out on the road and all of a sudden, I couldn't sing. And I didn't know why. I would come home and rest and work my voice and I would be able to sing.
At home you sang?
Yeah, and then I would go out on the road. And when it's time to go on stage, it wasn't working. And that went on for about a year or so. And I couldn't go in front of people and do that. And I remember in 99, I forget what month it was in, I was working in St. Louis and I went on stage and I told the people, thank you very much. It's been a wonderful, it's been a wonderful time, but I'm going home, goodbye.
Do you perform, or was
after the show? Right at the end of the show.
You knew you needed a big rest.
Yeah, I mean something was not right. I mean my whole life was getting real bad. At that time I was drinking too much.
Ooh,
and I had stopped smoking. I stopped smoking in '96 because I was a cigarette smoker too. I was trying to clean my life up, you know, trying to get myself back into doing, being better, being what I was and what I knew I could be. And the only thing wasn't right was my head. And I had to get out of there. And right after I quit, and when I remember when I came home, it was like a giant, somebody had lifted a giant weight off of me. I had never been so happy in my life.
You felt that?
I was so happy. I mean, everything was like, I mean, for about a year, I didn't want to do nothing. I didn't want to sing. I was just happy being home.
So the picture.
All this time, I had never been in my house. I mean, I was on the road constantly. I mean, we worked all the time, traveling. We went all over the world. I've been everywhere, sang everywhere, in front of everybody. And I got a chance to stay home for a while and not worry about singing.
Now the picture you're giving me of the stylistics is something totally different from what I've seen over these last several decades. You're telling me that the stylistics as a group was a road band.
Yes.
You're telling me that the first three albums, the major albums, where the hits came from, was all you.
Yes.
And you're telling me that you weren't really happy until you took yourself out of that situation.
Yes.
Now you're happy because you're performing. You're performing all the time now.
It took a little time. I didn't want to come back. I didn't want to. I mean, I was happy. I went I went back to school. All of that stuff I was singing and watching other people do or whatever. I wanted to learn how to, you know, what it was about. Because music was inside of me. When I left the group, my wife, and I was having trouble with my voice, you know, my wife told me, she said, music, your total music about you, it's not just your voice, it's you. And I learned that. She took me to, when I went to music school, she took me to music school like a parent would take the kid to their to kindergarten.
Take me to the first piano lesson.
She took me right to music school, enrolled me, and did the whole thing. And I went to music school for 3 years. You know, from the time I left the group, I went right back to school. And I stayed there until we put the new Stylistics together in 03. And I really didn't want to do that, because all the guys that was in the band that worked at that time with the old Stylistics, they were fired from the remaining members of the Stylistics, saying that they were too loyal to me and they didn't like certain things, you know, that was going on with them. So he fired them. They came around here to my house and sat down and talked to me. And I was like, well, there's nothing I can do about it, you know. I can't help you. I'm not singing anymore. I'm not with them. I have no influence on what they're doing. And I would see them every week because I'm a runner. And I'd be out in the street and I see everybody when I'm running. And they would come past and they would say, you ready to go back and start singing again? I said, no, I'm not singing anything. And like I said, for 3 years, I just didn't do anything. And a guy that I recorded, well, the Stylistics recorded an album, which was me again, with just myself singing almost everything, named Christopher Beeler. He has a record company called Forevermore Records. And he works with Amherst Records, who own the catalog of the Stylistics music. So the last three albums, the Christmas album and two or three other albums we did at the very last, at the end of the time that I was recording with them, Amherst were the producers. Christopher Beeler produced an album with us that never came out. But when I quit singing, Chris kept calling me, talking about, come on, Russ, I just want to record you. I said, Chris, I'm not doing anything. I'm not doing nothing. Look, every week he would call me, 3-4 times a week. He would just keep on, because Chris Beeler is the kind of guy that won't take no for an answer. He just kept on.
It's not a bad thing sometimes.
No, it's not. And he said, look, I tell you what I'll do. I'll give you the equipment. I'll buy the equipment for you, and you put it in your house. And whenever you feel like recording, I'll send you the tracks and just sing and, you know, do this one record for me. So he sent me the equipment. The band leader, Kenny T, from the old group, I was still in touch with him and all the other musicians. So I asked him to come over and help produce the vocals for me. And I'm right in my basement here in the house, and we did one song. That one song ended up being 17 songs. And my first solo album came out. So there was nothing else to do after that but put the group back together. I mean, it was like the Blues Brothers or something. When we gonna put the band back together? And I'm running in the neighborhood, and I would see Raymond Johnson. Raymond Johnson also sang with the Stylistics. The end of 1970, me and Raymond Johnson start writing songs together. Raymond was with a group called Portrait in Black, which was an offshoot of the group that I was in called the Monarchs. And we managed, the Stylistics managed them. So me and Raymond's mother and my mother were good friends. So me and Raymond started writing together and started doing some songs. So when their group, Portrait in Black, didn't become big, Raymond started to play guitar with the Stylistics. And I knew Raymond could always do this, because Raymond is one of the most talented people I've ever worked with in my life. He sings, he dances, he plays instruments, he can do it all. We lost James Smith in the original Stylistic group, and Raymond came up front, and he started singing and dancing with us. He became one of the Stylistics. And he was there from about 82, 83 till the middle 90s, and he left the group. He left the group, I guess, about 6 or 7 years before I did. And I would see Raymond. He would come up and he'd say, man, when are you going to put the group back together? I said, I thought you didn't want to sing no more. He said, I want to sing with you. So another guy that was in Raymond's group, Portrait in Black, is named Jonathan Buxton. We call him Falcon. He was in Portrait in Black. He brought him along with himself to put the new group together, the new Stylistics. Well, there was another guy who did choreography for the original Stylistics. The guy I mentioned earlier by the name of Alan Ranton that wore the glasses, that was David Ruffin and I was Eddie Kendricks, he was the cousin of him. And he did choreography with us. He came and was in the new Stylistics. Then the band came. Kenny got another member. Kenny got another member. And the atmosphere of being with these new people and the way that they thought and the way they acted, it rejuvenated me. And it's been, 12 years now, 13 years, and I still feel that way. I've never worked with people who I've liked as much. You know, not just making music or anything like that, I like them.
Yeah, the first time I saw your new group was when you were in Baltimore with Dennis Edwards at the First Mariner Arena.
Yes.
That was either 03 or 04.
Yes, it was during the beginning.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And we rehearsed and we got the music. We listened to something that the original Stylistics didn't do. That was another problem I had with them, was trying to reproduce that music. We would go out on the road and people would, you know, say to us all the time, and that's one reason why I fought so hard to try to get them in the studio, people would say, that don't sound like the record. You know, them voices, what y'all doing, that don't sound right. And that irritated me a lot. So I would constantly be at the guys, listen to the music. Try singing the songs the way you hear them. You know, not the way you feel like you want to sing them, but the way you hear them. So we can try to reproduce this music. When I got with the new guys, I got with people who understood that. That it wasn't just, you know, singing it like a bunch of yo-ho-ho pirates. You know, them songs are not like that. Them songs are very pretty.
Yes,
you know,
smooth.
Very smooth.
Philadelphia Soul has its own special, unique characteristics. And it's different from what we heard from Stax,
yes,
coming out of Memphis. It's different from what we heard coming out of Motown.
Yes.
And it's different from the doo-wop that we heard coming out of New York. Philadelphia, and what Gamble and Huff and Tom Bell put together, it's so distinctive.
Yes.
You can hear it right away.
And growing up listening to that, I think I automatically had that. Because I was trying to emulate all the people who had sang with Kenny Gamble and them, you know, before I did, so I automatically knew that. But I couldn't push that across with the new group. I mean, with the old group, the Stylistics. It just wouldn't sink in.
Well, telling me what you're telling me now gives me a much different perspective on the music and now looking back. So take me back to Betcha by Golly Wow, okay? First of all, it sounds as silly as anything. And if I said, come on, I want you to come into the studio and record this song I wrote it for you called Betcha by Golly Wow. Come on, jump in the lake.
Now that song, that's the one that got me.
Oh yeah.
When I went in to work with Tommy on that one, I fell in love. That's my favorite Stylistic song. I can sing it anytime, anywhere.
I can see why.
It has a different feel. It describes the way I feel about love. I mean, it's my favorite Stylistic song. And I love it when everyone else sings. About 16 different people have sang Betcha by Golly Wow. And I love the way they all do it. But my favorite is Phyllis Hyman. I love the way Phyllis Hyman sings Betcha by Golly Wow.
Well, my favorite is Russell Thompkins Jr. Okay, that's the one I love to listen to. And that's what I was listening to on my way here.
Okay,
I love the song, but like I said, if Linda Creed told me those lyrics, I'd say you're crazy.
But Linda Creed was a fascinating writer. We would sit in Tommy's office, and a lot of them songs were just being created at that time. She would might only have a verse, and we sit down at the piano, and Tommy would be teaching me the songs, and this is all we have right now. And okay, we sing that part of it. Then She come in, her office was next to his, and when Linda used to be in there writing, once in a while I would go over and look at her office. She would have her kids there with her, and they'd be crawling all over the place, running on, and she'd be in there writing lyrics and working out songs. And then she'd come over to the office where we were working, and Tommy'd look at the lyrics, and he'd sit down and he'd play, and he would sing part of it. He said, "No, that ain't it, Give her back the paper." She'd go back. And me and Tommy would sit there and play and listen to other songs he would be teaching me other things. Then about an hour or so later or whatever, she'd come back. And he'd sit down and he'd play it and he'd sing. And Tommy had this thing he used to say when things went right. He would say, "Yes, indeedy-dee." As soon as he would sit down and play that, when Linda brought it back, I would hear him say that. I knew that was the right lyrics.
So when they introduced you to Betcha by Golly, mm-hmm. Wow, were they together? Did they say, "Here, look what we did"?
That's part of the story. They didn't say, "Look what we did." He would only sit down and teach me the songs. He didn't say anything. Yes, she was. They were working on the lyrics back and forth. And that process went on the whole time I worked with Tommy. So he would sit down and he always, at that time, I didn't talk a lot, you know. I was quiet. With him, I had made up my mind during that time, and I think I was like that. My personality was to listen. Tommy Bell, when he would say that "Yes, indeed, E.D.", I knew it was right. I think I was saying that I didn't talk a lot, you know, and my association with Tommy Bell wasn't like friendship-like type of thing. It wasn't non-friendship, but it was, I listened.
Teacher?
Yes.
Student?
Exactly. I listened.
How much older than you was he?
Well, I think Tommy is about early 70s.
Okay.
70 or 71. So he had to be about 6 or 7 years older than me. Maybe, you know, around that area. Yeah. And
what I'm getting at, he wasn't the same age.
No, he was
far more experienced and far more skilled.
Oh yes, yes.
Than you young kids were.
Way.
Sure.
And
even beyond his years.
Yes.
He was far more skilled.
He's a
genius.
Yes, fascinating person to work with. At the time I didn't really understand what he was doing, but I knew that I should keep my mouth shut.
Absorb all you can.
And listen and sing.
And it served you well, didn't it?
Yes, it did. After I left working with Tommy, I had no problem working with any producer, any place, or any studio, you know, after that, because I had learned the process. And it helped me, you know, working with other producers. The only other producer I worked with that had that same type of relationship with working with Tommy Bell and Linda Creed was when I worked with Burt Bacharach. When I worked with Burt and Carl Bayer Sager, it was fascinating. I mean, these people had the same type of IQ. I mean, what you didn't know, they did. You know, when you got stuck, they knew the way out.
Don't take me there yet.
Okay.
I want to go there. Mm-hmm. That's another chapter. You are everything.
Right.
Everything is you. That song's another beautiful song.
Yeah, You're Everything, I think, is one of the popularity for You're Everything is different than the popularity of You Make Me Feel Brand New and You Make Me Feel Brand New and Betcha by Golly Wow. You Are Everything was like the male favorite, the song that men like, you know.
Well,
as I turned the corner, I called out your name. I thought it was you, and it wasn't you, you know, because you are everything. I mean, it was a man song. I think Tommy told me that he got that idea walking around somewhere downtown.
It reminds me so much of the Shy Lights. Have You Seen Her?
Have You Seen Her? Yeah. Yeah, it is the same. Eugene Record was a great writer too, and it's a funny thing. Back then, I think we had just put out. It was around the time of You Are Everything, And me and my wife was living further downtown. We had an apartment. We was living on 18th and Master in North Philadelphia. And we'd had the radio on in the room. And I told you I'm very inwardly competitive. And I had never heard of the Shylights in my life. And I'm full of myself. All I'm listening to is myself, how I should be. Oh, I got a record that's being played on the radio. And I'm listening, and one afternoon, this Have You Seen Her came on or something. Well, I forget this. One of them Shylight songs came on. I said, who is this? Who's singing this song here in the same voice that I sing
yes.
in?
Yes.
And I'm saying, who is? And it's sounding great. I'm like, oh my God, who is this?
And that was also 1971.
Okay.
That was also the same time because I could remember hearing that during those 5 days I came home on leave before I went back. And, that too surprised me. Not like Stop, Look, and Listen, but I remember hearing that.
I fell in love with the Shylights.
Oh, yeah.
Because Eugene was coming at you different than with us. We came at you with all slow stuff. Everything we did was all love, all slow, except for one, Rock and Roll Baby. Rock and Roll Baby was the most up-tempo song that we
had. Summer of 73, I remember that. Everywhere I went when I was in the Army, at that point, we were listening to the radio, of course, because I was at my duty station, Rock and Roll Baby. We'd go to this nightclub on the weekends, and this band would play Rock and Roll Baby. And it was it lit the place up. But it was a girl that sang it.
Oh, okay.
It was a girl that sang and danced to it. But maybe that's what they needed.
We had no up-tempo songs in the show.
So how'd that happen?
And so we had to put Rock and Roll Baby. It was another song that Tommy introduced me to. I think Tommy said they wrote it for his son. One of his kids. And in fact, when we did it on our show, and we still do it now because we don't have that many fast songs, we speed it up a little bit. So we can get a song where the people can clap their hands to.
Sure. And it's a song that makes you move.
Yeah, and we bring it up a little bit. But the Shylights, Eugene was coming with...
Old Girl. He had Old Girl out then.
All directions. For God's sake, More Power to the People. Old Girl, Write a Letter.
Now Write a Letter. Whoa, I love that one too.
He was coming.
A Letter to Myself.
He was coming to these songs. I mean, bam, bam, mm-hmm. bam. And I really, really got to, to like him. I met him and we would do shows together because he was such a nice guy also. These songs were being done. He was singing the backgrounds. He was singing the leads. He was writing them. He was playing guitar on them. I mean, he was doing everything.
Major Lance was
the
drummer.
Genius. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
The monkey time.
Yeah.
Major Lance, yeah.
Yeah.
And Gene quit almost, he quit twice. And he came back once, but he quit the same way like I did. Gene said he just woke up. I saw the interview when he an interview that he did with someone. But he said he just woke up one day, and his wife said it too. He woke up one day and he said he didn't want to go no more. I'm not going on the road. I'm not going. I'm not doing that. And he got God in his life, and he started doing that. His life changed.
I don't understand.
Trying to find
though.
Happiness.
It's great to have God in your life. It's great to always have God in your life, but I don't understand why you can't mix it with the music unless the music is making you do things like you mentioned before about the smoking and the drinking. Okay.
But it's not just that. It's the lifestyle.
Yes. Exactly. Well, tell me about David Ruffin. Tell me about Eddie Kendricks. Tell me about Paul Williams.
But I mean, even if you don't do that, even if you're not into drugs or drinking or smoking, that being on the road and being out there is a different type of lifestyle. It's very solitary. I mean, you're by yourself, you're living in hotels, you're eating, maybe with the guys or maybe by yourself. If you don't do them other things and party and stuff like that, you're like a zombie. So that's why that musical life sometimes dictate to some of the things you will do while you're out there.
Well, the way I see it from my perspective is you don't have to rehearse because every night you're on stage rehearsing, okay?
Right.
And not only that, but before you got up on stage, you were very good at what you were doing.
Right.
So it's not like you have to go build something.
Right.
All you're doing is getting up on stage every night and you're making more money.
That's when the show is going on. But what about the other 23 hours?
That's the hours that tear you down.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. That's where you fall apart.
Mm-hmm.
That's where if you're weak, you're going to crumble.
Yeah.
And that's what happens to so many of these guys. And that's why Eddie and David and Paul didn't make it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why you had to get out so that you would be able to make it.
My lifestyle, you know, drinking became a problem later, right about the time I was getting ready to leave the group.
In the 90s?
Yeah. But before that time, I was, like I said, I've been an athlete all my life. I played basketball everywhere I went. I mean, I played basketball all over the world. Every town, I used to squeeze the air out of my ball and keep it in a suitcase. Well, as soon as I got to a town, I go to a gas station somewhere, pump my ball up, and do what that young man is doing. Go out and
shoot. Well, we were sitting here on your basketball court.
And when I was home, I played basketball every day. I played basketball like that all the way until I was 50 years old. And Jones.
You still run?
Yes, I do.
Now, I run 4 miles every other night.
Okay.
And the other night, the odd nights, I ride the bike.
Right.
So I can't run consecutively like I used to.
Yeah, me too.
So I go one night run, one night bike, run, bike.
I put in about 3 or 4 days a week if I run.
Yeah.
Because my feet are getting bad.
Exactly.
And I do about 5 miles a day.
There you go.
But my brother-in-law just passed away. He was like my best friend. So me and him, we played basketball at least 3 or 4 times a week. Even while we played here on my court, we would go to the gym and play in different places. But I played everywhere. I mean, I played in celebrity games in China. I played in Australia. I played in Jakarta. I mean, and every place I've ever been, I've jogged also. I've jogged through the rainforest in New Zealand, played basketball there. So I've been an athlete all my life. So it stopped me from doing really bad things. You know, no cocaine and shooting up and things like that. But I came from a drinking family. My mother was a bartender. You know, and my father drank. And I started working in bars when I was 17. My last year in high school was when I did my first nightclub engagement. And it was my mother's boss owned a club. And his sons owns a lot of clubs in Philadelphia here now, too. It was the Cadillac Club. And we had an audition, and we went in there, we worked the Cadillac Club. My last year in high school, I would leave from a CYO basketball game, go to the club, do my homework in the club, and be in the club doing 5 shows that night. And I was 17.
Wow.
And that's how that all started. But sports never left me. You know, it was always inside of me. And you can't do, you know, you can if you, but you don't be getting high, shooting up and stuff like that, and having sports in your life if you're serious about it.
Yeah, but you also couldn't be 64 years old and keeping up the pace. You still continue to keep
exactly.
up and walk upright.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
So, you know, it would have worn you out by now. It would have grounded you into a fine powder by now if you didn't do what you do.
And if I hadn't left. I mean, me and Chris Beeler, we talk about this now. Chris always tells me, he say, Russ, if you had not left that group when you did in 99, you probably would be dead. And I think about that, you know, because it was really getting bad. It was really, really getting bad. I mean, I think it might have been the day I left the group or around that time. And that was in 99. I still drank beer after that, but I never drank another hard liquor again. Never no cognac or, you know, hard booze.
Whiskey or
never.
Rum or...
That, I mean, the day I left that group, I stopped. I've always been real good at stop doing things that was bad for me. I smoked and drank beer because I really enjoyed it.
But didn't that harm your voice? Didn't that harm your ability?
It didn't bother me.
Really?
In the long run, it might have contributed to the problems I had, you know, in 99. But the whole time in my career, it never bothered me. I mean, like I said, I've been an athlete all my life, but I started smoking cigarettes my last year in high school. I woke up one morning in 96, and I said, I don't want to smoke no more.
Good for you. Just like that.
Yeah. Just like when I said I didn't want to drink no more. And it was just like that. And it was all the way up until 3 years ago, maybe a little more, that I stopped drinking wine and stopped drinking beer. You know, so
if I offer you a beer now, would you drink it?
I've been alcohol free for 3 years.
Beautiful.
None.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And now take me back. We still got to cover some more of the hit songs. We still got to.
All right.
I want you to tell me about some of the hits. Let's see. We talked about Rock and Roll Baby.
You're Everything.
You're Everything. We talked about
Country Living.
We didn't talk about Country Living.
Country Living. There's really nothing special about Country Living.
What was it, a filler?
It gave us another up-tempo song. Country Living gave us another up-tempo song, and it's one of our most requested songs to do right now. We have another song we do that was around that time. Make the World Go Round was like a phenomenon because it hit an audience that I never thought and we never thought we would hit, jazz. We did People Make the World Go Round, and it was like, I think Tommy and them was trying to do something to make it was a message, like the way Marvin Gaye was doing What's Going On. You know, with the trash man digging my trash today and all that type of thing.
In Ball of Confusion.
Yeah.
With the Temps.
Yeah.
And, what other song was that? I was just thinking, I just had it on the tip of my tongue before Ball of Confusion came into my mind. But A Ghetto Child.
Right.
Spinners.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. These songs had some kind of a social message to convey, and this was yours.
Well, that was our song at that time, but I think that was a conscious thing because Kenny Gamble, Leon Huff, and Tommy Bell, their slogan, well, especially Kenny Gamble and them, is there's a message in the music. So everything they do, they try to put a message, you know, out there. So, but what People Make the World Go Round did was, I remember somebody had said there's a remake of People Make the World Go Round. I said, oh yeah, who's doing it? They said Milt Jackson, Modern Jazz Quartet. And my brother-in-law, he had been into jazz because he was a jazz DJ. I think he might have got the album for me, or maybe my wife did. But when I saw Milt Jackson had done People Make the World Go Round, I knew we were moving into another whole realm of music. And next thing I know, jazz people start doing everything that we would put out. You're Everything, Bet You By Golly Wow, You Make Me Feel Brand New. I mean, all the songs now have been covered by either classical jazz, straight ahead jazz, or especially now with jazz fusion, smooth jazz. And People Make the World Go Round is a song that we do in our show. We've always used it as a prop. The first time as a prop we did it, and we would do the whole song down. It has a musical ending on it that, mm-hmm. that lasts almost as long.
Instrumental,
as,
just yeah, instrumental, yeah.
As long as the song.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the first song out of the Stylistics songs that we did that had no background. It was just me singing. So the group would leave stage and I would sing the song on stage by myself with the band. When the musical part would come in, I would leave stage and they would play the musical part and we would change clothes and come back out on stage with a whole new, you know, outfit. So we've always used it that way. Even now, we do a long musical part on it. It's not so much leaving the stage or whatever, but we do a long musical part and it goes into another song the way we have it set up, you know, on stage. But it's always been a useful song to have in the show. along with, you know, it has a lot of fans who like
yeah.
the song.
Yeah. Okay, what other songs do we got to talk about?
Stone in Love with You.
Oh, gee, wait. How do we, there's just so many. I would have overlooked it. Yes. Okay. You started off and said, tell me about Stone in Love with You.
Stone in Love with You, I think, was the first song that I did with Tommy Bell that wasn't a Linda Creed song. It was Tommy's brother, Tony Bell. Tony Bell was the musical, at that time, he was the musical director for the Delphonics. And Tony wrote Stone in Love with You. Now, the crazy part about that song is, that's the only song I didn't do at Sigma Sound Studios. I did it at the old Cameo Parkway Studios.
Now, when you say Sigma Sound Studios, where is Sigma Sound?
Sigma Sound Studios was at 12th and Race. Let me tell you about Stone in Love with You.
Love the song. Love it.
Stone in Love with You, I would think, is one of our biggest crossover songs. Stone in Love with You was a hit everywhere in the world when some of the songs weren't. Stone in Love with You is a clap-along song that a white, black, Filipino, Japanese, German, whatever. Everywhere we go, when you do Stone in Love with You, they right away, they people perk up. That's the part of the show that's the perk-up song.
Does it come towards...
Put it about three or four songs down.
Really?
Yeah. And it's a perk-up song. After we done hit you with the Betcha by Golly Wilds and You're Everything, and Stop Looking, Listen, we throw Stone in Love.
Okay.
But Stone in Love with You was written by Tony Bell. It's the first song I ever done with Tommy that wasn't a Linda Creed song.
Now, who's Tony Bell?
Tony Bell is Tommy's brother, and he was also the musical director at that time for the Delphonics. And the day... That song, I remember Tommy gave me a schedule. He said, it's the only song I didn't do with Tommy too that wasn't done at Sigma Sound.
Sigma Sound, where is Sigma Sound?
Sigma Sound was at Crossing Road.
In what way?
Sigma Sound was the studio that made all the hits for
Well, even before that, that was where Chubby Checker recorded The Twist.
Yeah.
And the Dovells recorded.
Yeah.
The Times recorded there. Everybody, really everything that came out of Philadelphia came out of that door.
With the legendary Joe Tarsia.
Joe Tarsia was the engineer.
Yes.
He had that, he developed that
that
sound system, that board.
Mm-hmm. It was really, when I was working in them studios, the only people would be in the studio would be me, Tommy, and Joe Tarsia. And they had another engineer that came in right after that, during that time. I forget his name, he was very good too. But I remember it was just the three of us in the studio. And it was, you know, the lights low, singing them little songs, and being in the microphone. And I remember I smoked back then too. I had my ashtray here, I had my water here, and singing, trying to get in the mood.
Well, you're getting in the mood now. You can see yourself there as a young kid doing it. I'm watching you, and I could just see you walking in that door, going to work.
And working at Sigma Sound. I had been in a major studio once before that. I think I had mentioned earlier in the interview that when I left the Monarchs, I worked with sang with a group called a band called the Dynamic Showmen here in Philly. And they had a bass player by the name of Steve Mapp. And Steve was one of the engineers at Cameo Parkway. And one night, Steve let me come down in the studio. I think I was 17 at the time, my last year in high school, and let me sing in the studio, in Cameo Parkway studio. And it was a little while before I was back in doing that again, but that was my first taste of being in the studio. But that studio is where I did Stone in Love with You. But the story about Stone in Love with You, as I mentioned earlier again, I used to shoot a lot of pool. I mean, a lot of pool. I spent a lot of time in the pool room. I've had a pool table since I've been about 10 years old, 11 years old.
Pool, I'm trying to put the two together. Pool and Stone in Love with You?
Well, I don't see that day. 2 o'clock. And I was doing so well that I didn't want to leave. Now, the pool room was at 15th on Sydenham Street, 15th, and it's called Cecil B. Moore now, but it was Columbia Avenue. So the train runs on Broad Street. You take the train all the way down Broad Street, the studio was at Broad and Locust. So that only takes about 5-10 minutes by train to get down there. I'm trying to push it. I'm steady shooting pool. I'm looking at my watch. I don't want to leave because I was doing good. Mm-hmm. I gotta go. So I grab the pool stick. I leave out the studio. I run down the corner and stop at this bar called Mickey's Playhouse. I get me 2 bangs, jump on the train, go down in the studio, and go in there and sing Stone in Love with You. Tommy Bell, I remember him saying it to me. He said, I know where you've been. You've been at that saloon, haven't you? I'm saying it. I'm cool. Get up to the microphone, pow! I knock Stone in Love with You off. I mean, knock
one
it
take?
Off. Yep, knocking it off. One take or whatever. It was real quick. I knock it off. I'm out of here. Back to the pool room. Going back down there. Stone in Love with You might be the most perfect song I've ever sang in my life.
I can hear it.
It's only one mistake in to me. One mistake in there.
Want to tell me?
No. Everybody always asks me where that mistake is at. But there's only one part in that song that I listen to, and I know it's coming. And I'll be like,
Is it a mistake or something you could have done more perfectly?
Something I could have done better. But it, to me, it's a mistake.
Okay.
But everything else about that song, it's one of the only songs I can say to myself, you know, you did a all right job on that song.
I can't wait to listen to it again.
Until that one part come up. But that day, I remember that day. It was a hot summer day, too.
Any more songs you want? Any songs?
1972, that was, I think.
I was in the Army when I heard it, and I know that.
Yeah.
So it was 72, 73. Yeah.
No, 73 was Rock and Roll Baby.
No, what I'm saying was 72 and 73 when I was in the Army.
Okay.
So I know it was in that period when you say, you know, I'll never forget, August of 73. I don't know where it hit so big here, but when I heard it, July and August of 73, Rock and Roll Baby was the song.
Where you were stationed at in Louisiana?
I went from Louisiana. I went to Schofield Barracks in Hawaii. After I left Louisiana.
I played Schofield.
Did you play Schofield?
Yes, I played Schofield quite a few times.
Had to be after I left then, because if I saw everybody that came through there. Fifth Dimension, Supremes, everybody.
I worked Schofield, I worked Hickman.
Hickam Air Force.
Hickam.
It was one of the biggest Air Force bases in the world. Right next to Pearl Harbor.
Schofield is the Army base, right?
Army base up in the mountains.
I worked Schofield at a time when the soldiers were getting ready to leave to go. I think they were going to Vietnam or something like that, and it was an all-male show. And I remember us saying, man, we ain't never played where it was one of the women in the audience. Wonder how this going to be. It's all men. And when we came out there, and it was around the holidays, and when we came out there and we were singing them songs, it was guys out there sobbing. I mean, I remember feeling for them. It was like they was getting ready to go off somewhere, and their minds were...
But you already
different.
Had the big hits? You already had... Yeah. Okay, so then it had to be after 74, yeah. then. Yeah. It had to be after 74.
Well, they were getting ready to be shipped off somewhere, and it was all men. And I remember that show. And it was in Hawaii.
Okay. You remember it was what they call Conroy Bowl. It was an open-sided. It had a roof on it, but the sides were all open. You could look out and you could see the outside. Had no air conditioning.
We played a club.
Well, then there were clubs in Honolulu. What would happen is they would go down to Honolulu, play for pay. Okay, mm-hmm. Had to buy a ticket to get in. Then they'd come up the next night to see the soldiers, or vice versa.
No, not that kind of club. One of the officers' club.
It was the officer club. It wouldn't have been the NCO club, because the enlisted men's club. That was right outside my barracks, right across from J-Quad.
It was one of them type.
But it had to be the officers' club.
Okay.
That you played.
Yeah, it wasn't no pay, no.
But it was. It had to be after I left there. It had to be after 73.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I left there November of 73, just before Thanksgiving.
We did a real good show in Hawaii too.
Was it a big arena?
The ABC, the HBC.
The HIC. Honolulu International Center. It's
right.
Now called the Blaisdell Center.
Okay.
But I saw the Jackson 5 there. I saw Elvis in Hawaii.
Okay.
He was there.
Yeah.
Chuck Berry. I saw everybody there. Saw everybody. You played that too.
Yeah.
But that also had to be, I saw the Archie Bell and the Drells there.
That was in the 70s because I remember one of the original guys who left in the late 70s, James Dunn. James Dunn was at that gig.
But it had to be after the end of 73, because if you played in 72 or 73, I'd have been at the show.
Right.
I never saw you. Well, hey, watch the way you talk. If they're bringing my groups over to see me, I'm going, okay?
But I can't remember the exact time, but I know it was in the 70s.
Yeah, or it had to be, I'm saying, yeah. It had to be January of 74 on,
mm-hmm.
because I left at Thanksgiving of 73.
Yeah. We used to work Hawaii every year. It would be the end of the tour. We would start working here and we would leave, and we would leave working the United States. We would tour the States, then we would go to England.
Oh, England.
And we would stay in England for almost 2 months. Then we would go to Germany, and we'd stay there for close to about a month. We'd work all the bases in
Germany. I was just going to say, if you went to Germany, you were playing the bases there too.
Yeah, we played all the bases. Then we'd leave there, and we would go to Bahrain. We would go to Jordan, Abu Dhabi.
Well, you kept going east. Did you go to Japan? Then did you finish up in Japan and then go to Hawaii?
No. Let me go a little further now. We would finish the Far East. We would go to Jakarta.
Indonesia,
Singapore,
yeah.
Kuala Lumpur, the Philippines.
Yeah.
Then we'd go to Hong Kong. No, after the Philippines, we would go to Australia. We'd work Australia, we'd work New Zealand, then we'd go up and go to Hong Kong, then we'd go to Japan, then we'd go to Guam. And from Guam, we went to Hawaii. And then we was on our way home.
Right. Hawaii was always the last stop for all those groups. That's what they would always say. We've been around the world, and now we come here to entertain you soldiers, and now we're going back to the States.
If we didn't stop the work in California, we went home. And it was time. To go around the world. It was time. I've only done that a few times, and after a while I refused. I never like to go away from home that long.
Ooh,
you know.
What a grind.
Yeah, no 4 months and stuff like that. I never thought I had to work like that. And that's another problem I had with the other guys, where they didn't care. They go out on the road, they stay out there forever. I was, you know, I didn't want to leave my wife or be away from home that long. And a month to me was a long time. And I would push it to 2 months, you know, all the time, but I couldn't eat nothing, no. You Make Me Feel Brand New. You Make Me Feel Brand New was all right. I wasn't real crazy about it. I like the songs like I like every song that Tommy Bell ever gave me. And in fact, I loved every song that Tommy Bell gave me. But You Make Me Feel Brand New just didn't knock me over like Bet You By Golly Wild and all of that. But it knocked people over. And people were very, very crazy about You Make Me Feel Brand New. And the record company wasn't going to put it out as a single. I mean, it was one of the songs that we actually went to the record company and said, what is wrong with you? Are you crazy? I mean, we're out there with the people, and the people are asking for this song, you know?
The greatest commercial success.
Yes.
Not necessarily the best song.
No, but the greatest commercial success. So much so that it was put on the next album that we did that wasn't on AFCO Records. It was on H&L Records. Let's Put It All Together. So it sold on the Rock and Roll Baby album and the Let's Put It All Together album. It went double platinum in England. It went double platinum in Japan. It was everywhere. This song was to the point where I was saying to myself, I wonder why they like this song more than they like. It says something. For one thing, when you put God in a song, it sells. You know. God bless you. When you put God in a song, me and my wife was talking, I was thinking about God bless you. When you put God in a song, how it sells. And we were talking about the song that the guy put out, Happy. And I was saying to myself, I said to her, I said, all you have to do is put Happy in a song. Every song that Happy has ever been in has been a hit.
It lifts people up.
Mm-hmm.
Sunshine is the greatest antidepressant.
Right.
Makes you happy.
And You Make Me Feel Brand New was nominated for a Grammy. And we lost out to a song that I thought was a great song. Gladys Knight, Midnight Train to Georgia.
But yes, that was a great song. It's funny that you mention that because...
I know, Mavis.
They were up for a Grammy, the 72 Grammy, in 1973. And Papa Was a Rolling Stone beat them out. And she said exactly the opposite of what you said. She said, we got beat out by Papa Was a Rolling Stone, and our song was so much better than that. You don't say that, okay? You think it's funny, okay?
I know Mavis. And
Mavis, Mabel, yeah.
I like Mavis.
Mavis Staples,
Mavis,
yeah.
Mavis is a nice lady.
Yeah, but for her to say that, that kind of cranked me off, okay?
We toured for years with the Staples singers. For a long time we toured with Mavis. Mavis, Yvonne, Cleo, and Papa.
And she said that about Dennis' song not being good enough, and then you're saying we got beat out by a great song.
By a great song.
Yeah.
Well, I'm a big Gladys Knight and the Pips fan. It's the best singing group in the world to me. There's never been a singing group
between you and I, you talk about a real queen of soul, okay, that's it. She is it.
Yeah, I just finished doing the tour of the Soul Train Cruise with them. With Bubba and Gladys. And we saw Gladys in the early 60s at the Uptown Theater. And Gladys came out, and I think they hit record at that time was Giving Up. And they did Giving Up.
That was early.
Yep.
You're talking early 60s.
But the song I remember them for back then and I wanted to hear was Every Beat of My Heart.
Mm-hmm.
I knew all them songs, but I was the kind of guy, I only knew the artists. I never knew who wrote the songs, who produced it or anything like that. You know, when I was a kid and growing up, so I only knew that song by Gladys Knight. But when we left Tommy Bell, working with Tommy, that was around the time I wanted to leave the group too. I had to make the decision. We're not gonna be working with Tommy Bell anymore. What's the reason? Why should I stay here? Why don't I go off and do something on my own or whatever? And I was having meetings with Hugo and Luigi with the new record company, H&L, and management at the time.
Now, Hugo and Luigi, they had been around for a long time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They had done some things that were also extra special. Of course, my favorite one is Elvis Presley's Can't Help Falling
In
Love.
Can't Help Falling In Love. And we got on the label with them. I was debating where should I go, and they said, "Well, who am I going to be working with? I'm going to be working with Van McCoy." I don't know no Van McCoy. All right, we're going to change everything around. New studio, new town.
What new town was it?
We was going to New York to record at Media, 57th off 8th Avenue. Media Studio was a converted church. Very, very nice studio. The sound in there had that sound like. I said when you didn't use the microphone, how your voice could ring. It had them acoustics. And we went in there to do the first album, the Let's Put It All Together album with him. I really liked his arrangements and his music. I didn't like all the songs. The songs were corny. It was the first time that songs were being presented to me where I had to say, I'm not going to sing that. Because it wasn't black enough. I mean, it was very, very corny. I mean, and it was written by a guy who had wrote some hits, you know, was big in the business, George David Weiss. He was the president of BMI, of ASCAP. I really did not like these songs. I mean, I did Let's Put It All Together, Sing Baby Sing, a remake of Elvis Presley's song, Can't Help Fall In Love, up-tempo, sounding like a disco tune. I really didn't like this, but I was doing it. Because my mind at that time was, I didn't want to be there. I wanted to leave. I wanted to get out of the group. And that's when it really started to become a job.
They were making you
do. I really didn't like the songs. And I start coming home, and people here in Philadelphia and statewide were starting to say, they didn't like the change. They didn't like the songs we were doing. They wanted to hear Tommy Bell. But it became a job. And I think I remember doing an interview years back then. I told people, I said, it is no different than making shoes. You make one pair, make another. And I was just going in and cutting. But some of them songs I just refused to do because they were really, really bad. And once in a while, Van would put a song on there that wasn't, you know, that was pretty good. We would do one of his songs, but them songs was, I mean, it was strange. At that time, I just knew our career was over. But God put his hammer.
Your career wasn't over, and it's not over.
It
you
wasn't.
Just stopped recording new material.
No, I'm talking about then. I'm not talking about now.
Yeah.
But then, I started feeling like, this is over. We're going to just be a road group. The recording stuff is going to be over. Here come Can't Give You Anything But Love. We did that I Can't Give You Anything But Love, and it shot around the world. It was all right here. Double platinum in England. Double platinum in Japan. I mean, that song just went big. It's a Van McCoy Do the Hustle type song.
Yeah.
And it sent us into another. We stopped working home a lot, and we stopped working overseas. I mean, all the time. The records just became so big. A hit record, Sing Baby Sing. Na Na Is the Saddest Word. The Elvis Presley song, Can't Help Falling in Love, was a hit over in England, and Japan, in the Far East, and in Asia. Even now, we have to do a totally different show when we go to work them over there than we do here. Them songs was not making it here. I mean, we had a real bad row. I mean, this argument was almost a breakup of the group type of row. That for a while there, they started to treat me like I worked for them. They would sit down, make the song list. They would tell me what they wanted me to sing, when I should sing. I mean, all of these things, just like
I'm getting offended just hearing
this. Yeah, like I was an employee. And one time we went over to England, changed the show, stayed there for a long time, and I sang all the songs that were hits over there and there were hits in other parts of the world. And I had no problem with that, but we had a row. And when we came back to the States, I refused to switch back to do the songs that we did here in the States. And I did the show that we did in England at the Apollo Theater. And I came out on stage and I started singing them Let's Put It All Together and Na Na Means I Love You and Sing Baby Sing and them songs. And the people in the audience were looking at me like, I mean, they were flabbergasted. They was like, what in the world is he doing? And I was so mad. I was so pissed off that I just did it. And I did it the best I could. And the people had their mouth wide open. At least they didn't boo me.
Now, is this what the group wanted you to sing?
Yeah, with the Stylistics.
I mean, but they would have wanted to say, this is what you're going to...
No, they wanted to switch back. And I got tired of being used that way.
Okay.
And I refused to switch back.
You got tired of when they pushed the button, you had to
right,
jump.
Yeah. And I refused. And I stuck through it. And I sang them songs, and I did it. Finished the gig, and I left. Went home. But it was slowly building to that thing where I had to get out of here. I had to get out of here. I never wanted to make more money than everyone else. I wanted everyone else to put as much input into the group as I did. So we were getting ready to do this last album, and they were going to sign us to some label. I forget what the label was. That was in 99 or something like that, before I left the group. And I just told them, I said, look, I'm not singing all the songs. I'll do my share. there's three of us or whatever, and everybody else do their share. Evidently, the record company didn't like that, or whoever they were going to sign.
It was Herb and Arian,
yeah,
and you.
And me. It was only three of us at that time. I just refused. I had been doing it for 33 years. I don't know how many albums, how many singles, over 300 songs. You know, it was getting to the point where I was at the end of my rope. It was so bad that I informed them and the record company, everybody else, that we were going to do equal share, equal amount of work. So I went in the studio, and they had got this producer to come in there to work with us. And this guy totally disregarded everything that I heard. And he wanted me to sing everything. He was just throwing all these songs at me. And I just got mad. I turned around, I walked out of the studio and went home. I had never done anything like that in my life. And I knew it. It was coming. It was time to get out of here.
People say to me, oh, it's all about the music. It's not about the music. It's about the memories, because that music mm-hmm. was laid on top of those memories of me growing up.
Yeah.
You and I did a lot of things together, okay? You don't know about, but we went places together. And when I was in the Army, we were sitting out there trying to get through certain days together singing. We're singing the Stylistics songs, okay? We're sitting there waiting for the mail to come in. And the mail's going to be an hour late. The mail's going to be 2 hours late. You want to hear from home. We didn't have email back then 40 years ago.
Yeah.
So we're waiting for the mail, and we're listening to your music, and we're singing and dancing, and me and the guys are out there. And that helped us pass the time, you know?
Yeah, a lot of the, like I said, for 33 years or so, it was I wasn't the happiest guy.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a lot of things that went on. That was the brunt of my career. So there was a lot of wonderful things that were going on during that time. But I worked with Van McCoy, we got that hit, I Can't Give You Anything But Love. And it sent us into a whole new genre of music that people, because we had to fight through disco. Disco was putting artists like us out of business. I mean, them slow songs, they, you know, and plus nightclubs were turning into disco. And they weren't bringing in the acts, you know, all the places, the clubs and stuff we worked before were all bringing in DJs. So that whole thing, that's when I had that outlook of, uh-oh, it's going to be trouble, until that song came. And we worked with Van. I think we might have done, we did five albums with Van. And the association of working with him became very good until he got the hit. When he got Do the Hustle, he was gone.
Yep.
He was gone. And we did, I think, two more albums with H&L, and we worked with a producer called Horace Ott. And Horace was very nice to work with. But Horace had us doing things that was kind of Broadway sounding. You know, and it wasn't bad. We could do them songs, but there was no hits coming from it. We left him, and we worked with a person that was the next great producer that I really, really enjoyed working with. And they're two of my favorite albums that I don't like to listen to myself. I very rarely even play it anymore, unless I'm singing.
You're too critical.
Yeah, I don't listen to myself. But these albums I do. I work with Teddy Randazzo.
Teddy Randazzo.
We're gonna rock tonight.
And now, here is your own singing star, Tommy Rogers.
Go on.
This song is for someone very special who knows who she is.
I was wrong to make you cry. I will love you till I die. Give me one more chance.
Won't you give me a chance?
Yeah. Take me back. Wow.
And Teddy Randazzo did two albums for us. And they, for Mercury, we went to Mercury Records then. And a lot of people don't know anything about these records, but when they hear them, they really enjoy it. Two albums. We lived with Teddy. We went to New York, and and stayed in his house and went to studio and cooked and ate and hung out. And that was a great experience in my career, working with Teddy Mendaza. And after we stopped working with Teddy, we moved on. I think we went with, that might have been the early 80s. That's when we came back home and we worked with TSOP. Kenny Gamble signed us.
Yeah.
And that's when we got another record that helped us out. We did Hurry Up This Way Again. And Hurry Up This Way Again started opening the same doors again, got us back over the hump. And we did three albums with Gamble and Huff, and got a chance to go back and work with Tommy Bell. And we did an album with Tommy called Closer Than Close. That was nice. And after that, we went with, we worked with Maurice Starr from out of Boston that did New Kids on the Block. And with the Bobby Brown group, New Edition, he discovered and did them. And we did two albums with him that was good R&B albums. Then H&L, we did three albums. No, we got one other person in between there, Preston Glass. Preston Glass does music like Tommy Bell. And other people who Preston has done, I'm not quite sure about. But he's one of my favorite people to work with. In fact, Preston just sent me a bunch of songs that I'm listening to.
Really? New songs?
Yes. I'm listening to and working on them now.
So you're going to be recording again?
Yes. But I never stop recording. Me and Chris Beale at Forevermore Music, me and Chris, I go up to his studios in Rochester, New York, and I record every once in a while two or three songs and whatever. We got a whole clump of songs that could come out whenever he want to. And he's also did a live album on the new Stylistics.
What's the name of the group that's recording for him?
What, for Forevermore?
Is it you individually, or is it you?
Just me.
Not the new Stylistics?
No, just me.
Okay.
But he has done the new Stylistics live with the Myrtle Beach Symphony. And the Blue Notes are going to be there, and Blue
now,
Magic.
From the Blue Notes,
which no originals.
Am I right to say that almost all are dead, except for one?
Except for one, yeah.
Yeah.
Lloyd. Lloyd is the only one. And he has his own Blue Notes, and there's another Blue Notes. Hal Melvin.
His wife, his widow has them.
Yeah, has the group. Yeah, and I work with them a lot.
I was going to say, they don't sound too bad, but they got a girl in the group, don't they?
They did. They had Sharon Page in the group for a while, but Sharon's not singing anymore. But Sharon sang with the original Hal Melvin's group also.
Recording or on the stage?
Recording and stage.
Really?
Yeah, they had a hit record, I Hope That We Could Be Together Soon. He sang with Teddy Pendergrass, she sang with him. And I, away from you, girl, boy, how the time goes by. And when I think about you, girl, that's how it's something like that.
Beautiful.
It was a big hit record for them. Sharon has a very wonderful voice, too. She sang with Hal for a long time.
You know what? The group looks so different, but they sound good.
Yeah. Well, tonight, my next engagement, I'll be working in Sharon Hill, Pennsylvania, right down the road from Philadelphia, at Conway Park. And I'd like for everyone to come out and see us sing some of the songs from the 70s and take this trip with us.
Okay, I'd love to. Everybody's going to come with us. We're going to see you on stage with the new Stylistics?
Yes, you will.
Okay, let's help everybody see this. You have your time.
Oh, evening, a part of your life. Always remember that Russell Thompkins in the new Stylistics will love you forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Good night and God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, he is the original. He's there.